Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My name is Simon Evans. I'm the Pro Vice Chancellor International at the University of Melbourne, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you here on behalf of the university to this evening's public lecture. First, I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which this event is taking place this evening, the land of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and pay respect to their elders and families. I'd also like to acknowledge a number of people, starting, of course, with this evening's distinguished lecturer, Professor Wang Depei, Chief Economist of Forecast Thinktank. Professor Wang Depei is leading a delegation on behalf of Forecast Thinktank to the university and other Australian universities this week, and that delegation includes members of the Shanghai Entrepreneurs Association. So welcome, Professor Wang, and the Forecast Think Tank, and also the members of the delegation. I also need to acknowledge a very distinguished member of the university community and this evening's commentator, Professor Ross Garnaut AO, Professorial Research Fellow in Economics at the University of Melbourne. Emeritus Professor John Taplin, who will say a few words in a moment, and he comes from the Virtue Australia Foundation. A special welcome to Mr. Wang Xiaojia, who is the Commerce Consul from the Consulate General of the People's Republic of China in Melbourne. Welcome, sir. And also representatives from the Victorian Government, Victorian Parliament, Victorian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, and the business community. Representatives from the many university partners in this event, including AsiaLink, the Confucius Institute, the Centre for Asia Business and Economics, and AsiaLink Business. It's a long list. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome. Thank you for joining us for this public lecture, which is the first in a new series of lectures on Australia in the world. Australia's role in the world is an intensely interesting topic now, perhaps always, as the world environment, the world around us changes, and we seek to renegotiate, to understand more deeply how Australia fits in, how Australia contributes, and how Australia is seen. In understanding Australia's place, we also need to understand our neighbours, our friends, and their perceptions of Australia. And this evening's lecture on the future of the Chinese economy is an important factor in shaping our understanding of Australia in the world. The University of Melbourne is very proud of the breadth and depth of its academic relationships with China, Chinese institutions, Chinese corporations, and Chinese government. That's an academic relationship in research, in teaching and learning, and in engagement. Engaging with communities here in Australia to better understand China and its place in the world. Engaging in China to assist Chinese communities in understanding Australia and our academic community. So this evening's event is a great example of this form of community engagement. We're pleased to be hosting the event tonight, with China, engagement with China being so important as part of the global character of this institution. We are proud that so many of the academic units within the university that focus on China are involved in organising and presenting this evening's event. This evening, we look forward to hearing from two leading experts on the Chinese economy, Professor Wang and Professor Garnaut. They'll discuss future trends, opportunities, and prospects for Australia and China as the Chinese economy transforms to an innovation and consumption-driven model. But before I hand over to our distinguished speaker, Professor Wang, I'd like to introduce one of the key supporters of this event, Emeritus Professor John Taplin, who is Director and Trustee of the Virtue Australia Foundation, who has made this event possible. John, if you could say a few words, be very welcome.
Thank you very much, Professor Evans. Can I also acknowledge Professor Wang and Professor Garnaut, our two speakers tonight, and say hello to all of the other distinguished guests in the audience. We're delighted to see you all here. The Virtual Australia Foundation is very proud to be associated with this public lecture this evening. The essential aim of the Virtual Australia Foundation is to promote the development of commercially successful enterprises out of the world-class research that we are consistently producing in this country. And this university is a fine example of that. The importance of research and innovation in driving modern economies into the future is increasingly being recognised around the world. And this is true not only in Australia, it's also the case in China. So the Foundation is delighted to be a sponsor of this evening's lecture on the future of the Chinese economy, to be delivered by Professor Wang Depei. It's great to see so many people here for this important lecture by one of China's most eminent economists. We'd particularly like to thank the University of Melbourne for hosting the lecture and to acknowledge the wonderful cooperation we've received from many parts of the university, as well as AsiaLink, the university's Confucius Institute, and indeed the Faculty of Business and Commerce. We'd also like to thank Professor Ross Garnaut for agreeing to add his perspective at the end of the lecture by Professor Wang. So thank you very much. I hope that you enjoy the lecture as much as I'm sure I will too. Thank you.
So now to our distinguished speaker. Professor Wang Depei is the Chief Economist of Forecast Thinktank, Vice President of the China Society of Economic Reform, and visiting professor at many of China's most eminent universities, Peking University, Zhejiang University, Fudan University, Shanghai Jia Tong University, and Tongji University. He's been a senior consultant for over 1,000 industry and government projects with Forecast Thinktank. He's published speeches about Chinese macroeconomic situation, national strategy, development strategy for local governments and large enterprises. And he has written many substantial works, including on Chinese economy in 2016, the future of the Chinese currency, the renminbi, the fourth finance big bang, rebalance, the Chinese ascendancy in American power, and much more besides. Please join me in welcoming Professor Wang to the lectern for his lecture this evening.
I'd like to thank the University of Melbourne to invite me and let me be here and giving me this opportunity to discuss with everyone here about the complexity of the Chinese economy and this very complex topic, which is very hard to discuss.
整个世界进入到前所未有的复杂时代，在那么多的复杂中，大家都会认可，唯有中国的复杂才是最厉害的。
The whole world actually has entered a complicated era, but among all the complexities, we all have to admit that the complexity of China is the most.
我们在中国可以看到无穷的问题，社会、经济、环保一系列的问题，但是我们同时也看到，在太空中一两年以后。 竟然只有中国的这个太空船在那里，最近我们又看到了量子卫星跑到天上去了，在全世界的高铁运营中，中国竟然占了60%。一方面的问题，另一方面的奇迹，所以中国的奇迹和问题为什么可以共存，相形不悖？
In China, we can see countless problems in society, in economy, and in environmental protection. But we also see that in 1 or 2 years' time, in the space, we can only see China's spaceship, and also recently the quantum satellite has been sent up there as well. And also, in terms of high-speed trains, China takes up 60% of the world. So in China, both problems and the miracles coexist. So we would wonder why this would happen.
我在欧洲有一些朋友忽悠我，说如果我把这个中国的迷局给破解了，他们承诺给我诺贝尔奖。
So some of my friends in Europe, they actually told me, or they're trying to trick me, that if I can solve this puzzle, they will give me a Nobel Prize.
最近我有点紧张，因为来自美国有两个竞争者，一个是张家敦，一个是沈大伟。
Recently, I get a little bit nervous because there has been two competitors in the U.S. One is Gordon Chang, and the other one is David Shambo.
张家敦在2001年，他就写了一本书，预测中国在5年之内要崩溃。
Chang, in 2001, published a book predicting that China was going to collapse in 5 years' time.
最近他又有新的观点，说G20在杭州会议结束以后的半年，中国将崩溃。Recently,
he has updated his view. He's saying that after G20 in Hangzhou, five years time from that, China is going to collapse.
我没有把他看成是我的对手，因为他有偏见。
I don't really regard him as my competitor because he is biased.
但是有一位老兄叫沈大伟，他是正宗的美国人，常年在中国学习，历来对中国看好。但是就在去年，他是美国的一个中国通，也是美国关于中国的一个权威顾问，在2015年。 他竟然也观点改变了，说中国将崩溃。The
other person, David Shambo, he is an American, and also he has spent a lot of time studying in China, and he has been holding a positive attitude towards China as always. But just last year, he, as authority. In China's Chinese issues in America, and also a very important advisor in the issue. Last year in 2005, he changed his mind, saying that China is going to collapse as well.
科学的本质是什么？科学的本质就是实证和证伪。如果从预判的后果来看，张家敦的言论已经被证伪了。
What is the nature of science? It's evidence and deduction. So based on the result, Chang's prediction has been proved wrong.
接下来我将展示我对破解中国迷局的一个分析框架。我希望在座的所有专家能够见证是王德培破解了中国的迷局，还是张家敦、沈家伟。 我想在座的专家应该成为我的见证人。So
now I would like to show everyone my logic and framework to solve this puzzle so that everyone can be my witness to say whether or not Wang here or Shambo or Chan will become the right truthful predictor in terms of China.
在1998年，在中国的北京。 有50位专家在论证下一步形势的发展，当时的背景是东南亚金融风暴爆发，49位专家说这场风暴将席卷中国，都说中国接下来要出事情了，而且出的是大事。
Back in 1999, in Beijing, there were 50 experts who were discussing about the trend, the next step. And that was in the background of the financial storm in the Southeast Asia. So 49 of the 50 actually suggested that something bad was going to happen to China, and the financial storm is going to come.
但是第50位专家，他的观点是：中国进入新世纪，中国将进入起飞期，时间长达23年。这位专家的名字就叫王 Depei。
But only one of them actually said that China was entering a new era and is going to take off. And the period of rising will last 20 to 30 years. And that person's name was Wang Depei.
刚才在介绍我有一个头衔，国家经济体制改革研究会副会长，这顶花翎顶戴。
I was, as you just heard, one of my titles was the Deputy Director of the China's Economy Structure Reform Commission. And that title was actually the result of that opinion of mine.
我当时的分析逻辑是六大变量。第一个，中国将进入工业经济。进入工业经济，它的内在逻辑 决定了汽车、公路、高铁，决定了城市化的发展，所以工业经济的内在逻辑，它肯定就是GDP。由于中国的体量超大，所以进入工业经济，这个国家就将进入起飞期。I
listed six variants. First one is China was going into an industrial era and. Is going into industrial economy, which means cars, roads, and high speed trails will all be developed. And it also suggests the urbanization of the country. And the core of that is what's GDP. And considering the size of China, China is definitely going to take off.
第二个变量就是中国的国民禀赋，在以往的年代。 这个国民禀赋最大的特点是什么？就是劳动力。中国城乡的劳动力有7亿多，而美国的人口3亿多，欧洲3亿，所以中国的劳动力就相当于西方发达国家的总人口。The
second point I was making was the advantage of the people in China. The size of the labor force was 700 million people, and in America it was 300 million, and in Europe it was 300 million. So China is actually the combined size, it's the size of combined US and Europe.
过去这样的国民禀赋基本上是封锁在国内。自从有了WTO, 中国15年前加入了WTO, 关于这件事情，美国人今天很后悔。 当年批准了中国加入WTO, 他们曾经白宫有一个重大的酒会，在这个酒会上，他们说我们终于把中国人套牢了。美国在产业链、世界产业链，它处于高端，中国在世界产业链处于低端。但是15年以后，他们后悔了，上当了。
China joined WTO, which was 15 years ago, and that was a decision that the US has regretted ever since. At that time, they had this cocktail party in the White House, and they're saying that we're so happy that we finally got to take China under control. The US was actually the top of the chain, but 15 years later, they were very regretting.
中国的廉价劳动力和发达国家的先进技术以及外贸的通道结合起来，等于什么？等于廉价的商品。廉价的商品就像重磅炸弹一样，摧毁着一切民族的万里长征。这句话是当年马克思在《共党宣言》里面说的。
Chinese cheap labor plus high technologies from the developed countries, what's the result? The result will be very cheap products, and that product, that force, will destroy the great wars of any country, and that was a quote from Marx's.
第三个变量就是市场规模。市场规模如果说15年前中国手中的黄牌就是廉价劳动力，今天中国手中的黄牌已经是市场规模。The
third one is market size. If we say 15 years ago, the biggest draw card of China is the cheap labor. Nowadays, it's actually the size of the market.
我大概是在十多年前参加了一个国际会议，瑞典驻华大使，他说中国看不懂，后来他说某天我突然顿悟看懂了，原来中国是三个世界，1亿人口向欧洲，2亿人口向亚洲，10亿人口向非洲。
About 10 years ago, I attended a meeting and I met this Swiss ambassador. And the ambassador was saying that I could never understand China, but now after some observations, I do. China is actually made up of three worlds. One, 100 million people is living like European people, and 200 million is living like Asian people, and 1 billion is like African people.
今天10亿非洲人大部分已经变成亚洲人，变成欧洲人的已经有3个亿。 大家想一下，3亿欧洲人的消费量是什么样的消费量？对此反应最快的是澳大利亚总理，他在今年还是去年，带了1000多个企业家到中国去共同分享如此巨大的市场空间。
And since then, 1 billion African people have become Asian people, and that means in China now there are 300 million people who are living at the level of the European, and that becomes a huge consumption force. And in facing this force, who is the first to react? It was the Australian Prime Minister. I couldn't really remember it was last year or this year, but the Prime Minister led 1,000 entrepreneurs to China to share the market space.
这个就是特有的战略空间，中国的战略空间特别大。比如说，我就举一个高铁，中国目前已经在营运的是20,000公里，接下来我们还要达到47,000公里的规模。为什么有这样的高铁的发展？ 因为中国空间特别的巨大，日本民族我也很敬佩，他们很勤劳，但是在东京出发的高铁，汽笛一拉，北海道就到了，所以它的战略纵深远远不可和中国相提并论，所以有的时候还不仅仅是人的勤劳，战略纵深在帮助它。
And also, China has a huge strategic space. Let's take a look into China's high-speed trains. Currently, the coverage of the high-speed trains is 20,000 kilometers, and we're planning to expand that to 47,000. And why this is possible is because China has such a huge space. I admire Japanese people. They are very hardworking, but if you're in Tokyo and you get on a train and you almost arrive in Hokkaido rapidly, so I would say that hardworking is not the only trait, but also the space is also the key.
时间关系，我就想最后讲一个话题，体制改革，要回到我的那个头衔，副会长的头衔上来。中国原来是计划经济。 集权经济, 所以说什么叫经济改革? 经济改革在一定意义上就是打开潘多拉盒盖。 潘多拉盒盖一打开, 那个反映生产力的魔鬼就释放出来。 从这个意义上讲, 其他发达国家, 他没有改革这个概念, 因为他们原本就是市场经济。 中国是在计划经济这个概念上进入市场经济, 所以它释放的动能是极其大的, 而且这个释放今天仅仅是在半道上。 我们今天对中国有许多认为政策体制方方面面不满, 换个角度就意味着这些都是中国未来的发展空间。
Because of the time limitation, I will come to my final topic. I would like to talk about structural reform in China. China was in a planned economy, but I would like to talk about structural reform. What is reform? Reform is actually to open the box of Pandora and to release the devil of productivity. And all the other developed countries, they don't really have this concept because they were already having market economy. But in China, it's transformed from planned economy into market economy, and productivity was released in this process. And actually, we are still halfway there. And many people are not happy about Chinese economy. But I would say this means China still has a lot of room to grow.
现在我想用两个问题作为转折，转到下一个话题。都在说，嗯。Now
I'd like to use two questions as the turning point into and lead to my next part.
都在说中国人的。 印钞、印货币的能力，世界第一。都在说中国目前的房价像火山一样的在爆炸，所有这些问题都是中国体制决定的。Everyone
is saying that China is the first country in term, the first in the world in terms of printing money, and China's housing price is exploding like volcanoes, but these all decided by structure.
但是我现在展示另外一个逻辑线，这个逻辑线就是，超越中国，实际上澳大利亚也深陷其中的一个五个大泡沫。哪五大泡沫？第一个就是金融泡沫。
Following the logic, I would like to talk about the five bubbles that not only affect China, but also to Australia. And the first one of them is financial bubble.
金融泡沫自从08年金融危机以来，大家已经耳熟能详。但是我今天要强调的是，金融行业在自由的市场经济，在华尔街的极端的发展中，它已经脱离了实体经济。 成为一个自娱自乐的一个很庞大的，我顺便再给他一个标签，具有原罪的这样的一种产业，所以金融泡沫的爆发，在我的观点中，它就像每个人具有原罪一样，所以它也不存在美国人错或者说中国人错，这场泡沫的爆发。
Since the financial crisis in 2008, everyone is very familiar with financial bubble. But I would say that the financial industry has become, well, under the operation of Wall Street, financial industry has become a large, self-entertaining industry. And also I would like to add another label onto that, which is original sin. That means the bubbles actually means it's not the Americans, the US's fault, it's not China's fault. It's because what the finance industry is.
第二个泡沫就是央行泡沫。按理来说，经济出问题了，央行各个国家的央行应该调结构，但是错了。从美国的伯南克危机爆发，他在做电视节目说：“各位甭恐慌，我将派直升飞机飞到华尔街上空，向底下抛撒货币。” 所以它有三大次的所谓的货币的量化宽松。The
second is central bank bubble, and when that bubble appears, normally the central banks will take initiatives to make adjustments. For example, in America, when the crisis came on television, he said. We are going to spread money from a helicopter on top of Wall Street. And that is actually what he did. They have taken three quantitative easings in America since the crisis.
中国总理也紧紧跟上，只是我们的央行也是量化宽松。日本的安倍晋三一看老大美国，老爱中国。
The premier in China, our premier, also saw the opportunity and our central bank took the quantity easing initiative as well. And Japan saw, well, its big brother America and then the second in the world, China, all take the same decision. So I'll do that as well. So they started printing money.
在这个过程中反应比较慢的 是欧盟、欧元区，他们的行长强调要有原则，要强调财政和金融的平衡。由于他们这样的一种坚持，所谓的政治的准确，结果使得整个欧洲很紊乱，至少是紊乱的原因之一。但是他们最后认识到，国家不得不做这件事情，所以。 在2015年，他们做的比前面几个国家更狠的一个金融政策，就是负利率。The
only one area that didn't really take such decision or action was the Europe zone, and their central bank decided that we have to act with principles, and they are looking more into balance. That made the Europe, that led Europe into a completely mess. And now they finally realized. So in 2015, they have decided to make even harsher or harder decision compared to the previous countries, which is minus interest rate.
中国有一句古话说天下乌鸦一般黑。所以从这个意义上讲，全世界的政要 没有意识形态，没有社会制度的差别，他们都在干一件事情。
So in China, that's all saying that all the crows in the world are in the same black color. So from this case, we can see that all the politicians, it doesn't matter which country they are from, they are all doing one thing.
所以这场央行的货币泡沫是超越国界的。 超越政治的，现在第三个泡沫就产能过剩的泡沫。产能过剩的泡沫主要集中在中国。中国的制造能力差不多可以提供全世界的消费。问题是中国的巨大的产能哪里来的？国家统计局对外宣布，在中国的外资企业达到80万家。
The third one, so that was the central bank bubble, and that bubble actually goes beyond boundaries, territories, and beyond politics. And the third bubble is the capacity bubble. Currently, China has the capacity to meet the demand of consumption of the whole world. And where did we get that capacity from? The Chinese Statistics Bureau has reported that there are 80 foreign companies in China.
当年西方许多企业面临着巨大的税收压力，突然他们发现东方有一个古老的国家搞市场经济改革了，所得税可以免，土地可以送给你，环保可以无所谓，哪有这样的肥田沃土？所以全世界的制造业云集中国。
So once upon a time, the companies, the businesses in the Western societies were suffering from heavy taxation. And suddenly there is an ancient country in the East has decided to open the market and to convert this market into a market economy. And you don't have to pay income tax, and you can get the land for free, and you don't have any pressure from the environment in terms of environmental protection. And this appeared to them as a such wonderful environment to invest. So at that time, many manufacturers came to China.
所以这个产能过剩，与其说是中国的，不如说是世界的。
So I would say that capacity bubble is not only the China's problem, but also the responsibility should be shared by the whole world.
当金融泡沫、货币泡沫、三大泡沫汇在一起了以后，就形成了全世界的货币，形成滔天洪水。这样的货币，许多持币者很紧张。
So when the financial bubble, the central bank bubble, and the capacity bubble were all combined together, the whole world has so much money, it's almost like a flood. So that means everyone is actually trying to find a safe island.
所以他就来到了第四个泡沫，资产泡沫。什么叫资产泡沫？ 那么多的货币到哪里去？最后资产就成为持币者的主要选择，所以也成为墨尔本房价为什么会高，悉尼房价为什么高？新闻都在说中国的房价暴涨，但是我们从世界的统计材料看，竟然中国的房价还不在全世界房价上涨前10位的名单内。
And that led to the fourth bubble, which is the assets bubble, because there is so much money. Where should we spend it in? So assets became many people's choice. That's exactly why the housing price in Melbourne is rising and the housing price in Sydney has been rising. In the news, we hear it all the time that the housing price in China is increasing rapidly, but it's reported that in a global view, China is not even in the top four in terms of house price growth, but in Australia, two cities are on that list.
第五个泡沫就是科技泡沫，我估计我没时间展开了。The
fifth bubble is the science and technology bubble. I don't think I would have time to go into that in details.
各位听到现在，估计有一个感觉，在我的整个逻辑框架中，没有政治领导人的位置，因为在我的分析中，内在的基本结构是主要的，而政治领导人的态度。
So everyone probably is having this impression that in my analysis, the political leaders don't really have any position in it. And my analysis is saying that the economy is decided by its internal structure. And the attitude of the politicians are not as important or not important at all.
美国沈大伟教授之所以在2015年他发表《中国崩溃了》的文章，主要的依据是中国新一届的领导人，他们的举措，他认为 可能会引发问题。
The reason that Shambo in 2005 published an essay saying that China is going to collapse is that he thinks the new leaders in China, their actions will lead China into collapse.
在我的分析中, 真的没有他们的事情。
In my analysis, it's not the political leaders' business.
比如中国最近学界经常有一个词叫顶层设计。
For example, in China, in Chinese academia, there's one word keeps coming up, which is top design.
但是用科学实证的角度，政委的角度，我们看一下2015年、16年中国发生的两大事件，一个是金融，2015年，银行三会你翻不了，2015年金融的国家的金融方面。 金融政策部门方面认为应该有一个牛市，股市的牛市，认为互联网金融是新生事物，应该支持它的发展，认为8月11号中国的外汇改革会让人民币国际化，让中国世界经济再上一个台阶。
So from the scientific point of view, I would like to talk about the two events, the two major events happened in 2015 to 2016. The first one is finance. The Chinese finance policymakers or policymaking institutes has decided that China at the time decided that China should have a bull market. And also they saw the internet finance as a new thing and very much would like to support it. And also in August, they believe that the foreign exchange reform happened in August will take China into another level in terms of on the international stage.
但是牛市变成了股灾，互联网金融 P2P 变成了骗子的主战场。8月11号的汇改。 最后，央行砸了5000亿美元，砸进去。最终，在2016年，整个中国的金融政策出现了方向性的调整。由2015年的金融闯关，变成了2016年的金融管控。
But at the end, bull market has become a stock market disaster. And the internet finance, P2P, has become the battlefield of frauds. And the reform happening in August has costed the government's 5 trillion renminbi to make amends. So in 2016, they have changed the direction of the policies. So we changed from 2015's trying to conquer the difficulties to 2016's trying to control the economy.
2015年年底，中国开了一个重要的经济工作会议，在这个会议上判断，中国的房地产进入到过剩，要去库存，然后从金融、从买房出了一系列的政策，对它进行了鼓励。 但是到了年底，2015年的年底和2016年的上半年，最后引发了整个中国一线城市、沿海一线城市和二线城市，甚至是三线城市的房价的猛涨。
At the end of 2015, a very important meeting in China, which is the economic meeting, central economic meeting in China, happened. And on the meeting, they were saying that they have decided that China's property market has entered into oversupply status. So they've decided to put into policies to reduce the stock put into policies not only in finance but also in purchasing. So at the end of 2015 and in the first half of 2016, it had a huge impact. In not only the first tier, but also second and third tier cities in China, the house prices had increased.
这两件事情都标志着，实际上不存在顶层实际，不存在政策的影响占主导的，政策不占主导。所以在中国的经济发展过程中，我还是那句话，领导有的时候的作用是极其有限的，但是他们的自我感觉是极其好的。
So from the two cases I talked about, we can see that the top level design doesn't really exist. And in China, there is never such thing as the economy is led by policies. And for the political leaders, what they can do is very limited, but how good they can feel about themselves is unlimited.
当下中国出现了一系列的问题，中国崩溃论，中国GDP将大幅下滑，这种言论又开始上来了。但是如果各位听懂了我一开始讲的，我在1998年预判中国未来进入起飞期的那个逻辑，如果依然存在的话，中国的GDP 现在6到7之间的增长依然占世界GDP 增长的 40%。
So currently, China has a lot of problems, and many people are saying that China is going to collapse and the GDP is going to drop. However, if you have been following my logic when I was talking about what I suggested in 1998, if the logic is still there, then that means that China's GDP is still having a 6 to 7 growth, and that takes up 40% of the world.
现在中国正在面临一个重大的转折，这一条被人们关注的不多，主要是新旧经济的替代正在发生。所谓新经济，在我这里就讲8+X。
Currently, China is at a turning point, but that hasn't really drawn a lot of attention, which is the new economy replace is happening, and in my point of view, is 8+X.
比如工业4.0, 比如现代农业，再比如物联网，还有材料革命，以及生物经济。 生命经济，体验经济。
For example, Industry 4.0, modern agriculture, internet, material revolution, bioeconomy, life economy, and experience economy.
关于机器人，中国已经有几百家企业，几十个工业园区。关于石墨烯，全国也有几十个工业园区。 在做石墨烯原材料的突破，新科技革命的前提，往往在于材料革命，所以材料革命已经开始开启了。In
China, there are hundreds of businesses are doing robotics, and there are dozens of industrial parks that is doing robotics manufacturing, and new technology. The normal starting point of new technology is material revolution, and in China, it is happening.
体验经济我要着重说一下，体验经济，比如说网游、网络游戏，比如说 VR， 但是我在这里说一个与澳大利亚有关的体验经济，就是体育。凡是世界上人均 GDP 达到8000美元以上，就将进入文化产业。 体育产业，现在在体育产业中，全世界是15000亿美金，美国占了1/3，美国的体育产业占它的 GDP 是3%，中国是0.3%。
Next, I would like to talk about the experience economy. There are online game industry, there are VR industry, but today I would like to talk about an industry that is closely related to Australia, which is sports industry.
如果把澳大利亚的
In all the countries, any country, if they have a GDP per capita over $8,000, they will enter the culture industry and sports industry. In the world, the sports industry is worth $1.5 trillion, and America is taking a third of that. And in Americans' GDP, sports takes about 3%, and in China, it takes about 0.3%.
如果仅仅把澳大利亚的各种俱乐部 澳大利亚体育产业在GDP中的比重放到中国去, 中国的GDP的增长就将有很大的一块。
So if we bring all the all the Australian clubs and also the part in Australian GDP that is contributed by Australian sports industry to China, that will make up a huge part of China's GDP.
澳大利亚许多朋友都忽悠我，说如果把橄榄球引进到你们国家，将带来巨大的变化。我不相信，所以我这个月的11号，我就亲自到现场观摩了澳大利亚国球的年度总决赛。Some
friends in Australia told me or tricked me, trying to trick me. They're trying to ask me to, they're saying that if you can take AFL into China, that will make a huge impact. And I don't believe them. That's why I attended the grand final this year.
万人空巷的这样的一种场景, 所有参与者打扮的花枝招展, 像参加嘉年华一样, 10万人同时欢呼。 我曾经看过材料, 在英国有一场比赛, 10万人一瞬间的爆发, 竟然边上地震测试仪, 达到了0.3级的地震。
So what I've seen is the city has been stopped, and everyone has been dressed up, just like they're attending a carnival, and also tens of thousands of people cheering at the same time. I read this in a report that in England, there was one time that tens of thousands of people cheering at the same time, and there's a detector right next to it saying that it's in the equivalent to a 0.3 level earthquake.
我注意到澳大利亚，首先男人长得帅。在美国有一个朋友说， 你老兄怎么长得像澳大利亚人? 我问什么意思? 他说等于帅。
Also, I noticed that Australian men are very handsome. And one of my American friends once told me that you look very Australian. And I said, what does that mean? He said, that just equals handsome.
在一定意义上，澳大利亚是一个岛国。这个岛国，诺贝尔奖竟然有十几个。最后我研究， 原来崇尚体育、崇尚竞争的这样的一个民族，内心是狂野的。这个狂野的内心是要靠体育产业来点化、来推动的。而中国人相对的来说，我们习惯于打乒乓，很难去面对面的进行碰撞，所以引进 澳大利亚的橄榄球不仅仅是带动中国的GDP，刚才我提到的新经济的八个领域，都需要企业家、科学家内心的狂野去突破、去创造。所以也是这两年我到澳大利亚来的次数越来越多，朋友越来越多的原因之一。
Australia is, in a sense, an island, but there has been dozens of Nobel Prize winners in Australia. So I would wonder why. Then after my observation, I realized that the sports heritage actually established a certain wild spirit in Australians. And that wild spirit certainly needs the sports industry. And in China, we only play ping pong. So that's very different from AFL because it doesn't really involve any confrontation, direct confrontation. And if AFL can be brought in China, it will not only be part of China's economy, but also will be helping Chinese people to find a wilder spirit, just like Australians. And also, in terms of new technology, we need the entrepreneurs and scientists have a certain wild spirit to make breakthroughs. And that's exactly why, in recent years, I came to Australia more and more frequently.
最近关于中国另外有一个有争议的话题，就是这个国家已经容不下市场经济民营企业，以致民营企业四处出走。对于这个话题，我先说一个判断：中国庞大的产能，靠自身的市场是绝对消化不了，因为中国的产能是世界的，所以要让中国的产能 实现平衡，这样的产能一定要走上世界。所以在这个背景下，民营企业家仅仅是他的载体之一。There
has been a very controversial opinion around saying that in China the market economy is not going ahead, and also that has been forcing the private businesses to leave the country, and to that opinion, my view is that Chinese capacity is not only to meet the demand of Chinese consumption, but to the demand of the world. So that means Chinese businesses need to go overseas, go to the world stage, and the private businesses are just the carriers.
我们的第一站，许多企业家到了一个科技强国，以色列。以色列的科技发展相当了不起。最后，我们企业家在考察的过程中，听到了枪炮声。因为在以色列，即使世界宗教的主要发源地，也是当今世界宗教的竞争的闹冲突的主要场所。
Our first step, our entrepreneur's first stop was a country of innovation, which is Israel. Well, when they were investigating in Israel, they heard the sound of gunfires. And Israel is not only the origin of many of religions, but also the battlefield of many religions as well.
但愿这里没有以色列的朋友。
And hopefully we don't have any friends from Israel here.
结果我们最后发现，一个太平洋环绕的澳大利亚，没有难民，没有恐怖，没有种群的冲突问题。最后，我们的企业家得出一个结论：这是中国企业家的新大陆，是世界的21世纪新经济的诺亚方舟。
And then we turn our eyes to the country in the Pacific Ocean, Australia. We realize that there's no refugees here, there's no conflicts between races here, and there's no terrorists here either. So we feel like we found a new continent and we found the Ark of Noah.
要讲清楚澳中关系的未来，我想也要给一个框架。 这个世界已经分成三个类型的三个世界。第一个三个世界，就经过这场金融危机以后，拥有综合国力的，它依然是第一世界；第二世界是制造类的国家，德国、日本、中国；第三类，第三世界是以资源为主的，产业结构偏态的国家。那么在这三个世界中， 第三个世界，第三类，是这场危机的主要的受害方。If
we're talking about the future of Australian and Chinese relations, I would like to talk talk about it in the framework. In my opinion, after the financial crisis, the world has divided into three worlds. The first world, of course, was the countries with a strong combined capacity and power. The second world is made up of the countries that are based on manufacturing, such as Germany and Japan and China. The third world is made up of countries that are based their economy on resources. And this third world is actually the victim of this crisis.
但是在这三个世界中，我没有找到澳大利亚在哪里。
But I can't identify where Australia belongs in these three worlds.
第二个三个世界，我是对2040年的预测前提下的三个世界。在2040年，世界上将出现两个前所未有的超级大国，一个是美国。 GDP 将是现在的17万亿变成21万亿，第二个将是中国 GDP 由现在的10多万亿变成41万亿。
My second three worlds view is about my prediction of 2040. By 2040, we will have two super countries. The first one was the U.S. Their GDP will convert from 19 trillions from now to 20 trillions in the future. And the second is China, which GDP will rise from 10 to 40 in the future.
对此，全世界都没做好准备，包括中国的领导人。
And to this, no one in the world is prepared, including the Chinese leaders.
超级大国另外还有迷你型的强国。 像瑞士，像新加坡，甚至是以色列等等，是迷你型的强国。There
are also some small but strong. There will also be some small and strong countries, including Switzerland, Singapore, and even Israel.
中间一档，那就是以一亿人口为单位的，像日本、俄罗斯、英国等等。
In the middle is the countries with the populations of hundreds of millions, including Japan, Russia, and. Boy, 最后一个国家是什么？英国 and England. Excuse me.
一亿人口为首，我在这三个世界中依然没找到澳大利亚。
And in these three worlds, I cannot find where Australia is either.
我在另外一个三个世界终于找到澳大利亚。I
managed to find out where Australia is in another three worlds.
未来的世界是一个三角形的，一条边是美国，一条边是欧盟，另外一条边是中国。In
the future, the world will be in a triangle format. U.S. is on one side, Europe is on the other side, and China is on the third side.
在这三条边中，中国这条边最短，所以中国客观上会和俄罗斯走得很近。In
these three sides, Chinese ones is the shortest, so it is very likely that China will have a close relationship with Russia.
欧盟这条边也不稳定，它自身的问题很多，它还将有长期的磐石底部的时间。
The side of the Europe is not stable either, so they will have a long time to try to find their foundations.
美国有两个铁杆的朋友，一个是英国，一个是日本。And
in terms of US, the US has two iron friends. One of them is Japan, and one of them is England.
这个时候澳大利亚出现了，它以什么姿态出现呢？我们说。 小小羽毛压天平，澳大利亚不能说它是小国，760万国土，它是一个大国。但是澳大利亚人口只有像上海一样多，2400万，所以它是一个中等的强国。但是它的位置很特别， 这个位置决定了澳大利亚是一个压天平的砝码，所以澳大利亚是一个砝码型的国家，它压向哪，整个天平就倾向到哪里。
And this is where Australia appears. In China, we're saying that a feather can change the weight, a feather can change the balance, can break the balance. And in terms of Australia, we can't really say Australia is a small country because it has land of 7.6 million square meters. And also we can't really say, but with this vast land, China, Australia's population is only of the size of the Shanghai city, which is 24 million people. So it is right in the middle. However, Australia's position really matters and will be able to make a difference because it can break the balance.
澳大利亚是一个很念旧，也很仗义的国家，因为历史原因，他要跟着老朋友走，我认为是很有道理，我也很欣赏。但是澳大利亚又是很实际的国家，澳大利亚要追寻自个的利益，澳大利亚要追寻未来的发展，所以他也很希望结交新朋友。
Australia is a very heritage-based country, and also Australia pays a lot of attention in friendships. That's why I admire that Australia wants to be close to its old friends. However, Australia is also a very practical country, which means Australia look out for its own interests and also look out for its own future. That means Australia will need to make some new friends.
在历史和未来的平衡中，谁能把握得很好？ 我想有一个高人，他在这方面的描绘要比我有水平的多。Who
can who will be able to manage the balance between the past and the future? There's a person who made a much better comment in that than me.
这位高人就是高教授。This
person is Mr. Garnaut.
谢谢各位。
Thank you very much.
非常感谢王德培教授就中国经济的未来以及澳中关系的走向做得非常精彩的演讲。 Thank you very much, Professor Wang, for sharing your insights on the future of the Chinese economy. And well, here. Everyone, if you don't know, you can also follow Professor Wang on his WeChat account and also on the Forecast Thinktank account via WeChat. Maybe some Australian friends do not know about WeChat. You can take a picture now and then download WeChat. It's a free app that if you want to do business with China, everybody has to have WeChat. So can download it after the event. And yeah, we encourage you to follow Professor Wang's WeChat account. Thank you once again. And now, I think it is my greatest pleasure to invite Professor Ross Garnaut AO to respond from an Australian perspective. Well, many of you know Professor Garnaut very well. Professor Ross Garnaut AO is a professorial research fellow in economics at the University of Melbourne. And his career has been built around the analysis of and practice of policy connected to development, economic policy, and international relations in Australia, Asia, and the Pacific. Professor Garnaut has held senior roles in universities, business, government, and other Australian and international institutions. He was also the Australia's ambassador to China from 1985 to 1988. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Professor Ross Garnaut AO to the lectern.
Well, thank you, and thank you, Professor Wang, for that very challenging lecture that can give rise to lots of discussion. For those who do not know, Professor Wang Depei began his career as a philosopher, his philosophy degree from Fudan. And I think that philosophy is a very good place to start economics. The founder of modern economics, Adam Smith, was a professor of moral philosophy at Glasgow University. And John Maynard Keynes, the greatest economist of the 20th century, his first publication on the theory of probability is still taught in first year philosophy classes in good universities. So Professor Wang's starting place is a good starting place for economists. Professor Wang invited us to contemplate the complexity of China's current economic situation, and I think that's a good place to start. Anyone who thinks that they understand the whole Chinese story as a simple story actually is demonstrating that they don't understand China very well. I myself began following the developments in Chinese economic reform and the Chinese economy closely in 1979 when three of us were invited to Beijing to receive a series of briefings from the State Council on what were to become the reforms. And that was so interesting and compelling that from then on I was following developments in whatever else I did. And I've, in the several decades, nearly four decades since then, there are times when my fellow Australians have thought that I was an optimist about China, and times when they thought I was a pessimist about China. When I thought I had a pretty steady view of where things were going. But there were huge variations in foreigners' perceptions of China, periods of over-optimism, periods of over-pessimism. So if you maintained a steady view, there were times when people thought you were over-optimistic and other times when people thought you were over-pessimistic. But generally, the story has been a very steady one. The challenge facing China in 1979, after the decisions of the Central Committee of the Communist Party in December 1978 to embark on reform and opening of the economy to the outside world, were fundamentally difficult. Reforming a centrally planned economy is in its nature extremely difficult. And none of the Soviet Union did not succeed in reforming a centrally planned economy, moving towards a market economy without an historic dislocation. And much the same is true of all of the Eastern European countries, some better than others. So one must recognize the difficulty of the task. And China's reform has unfolded pretty steadily. There have been bumps along the way, but generally we've seen consistent movement towards greater integration in the international economy, a greater use of markets at home. But within that steady story, there have been a couple of points where I have wondered if the next stage was going to be as smooth as those that went before. One of those stages was from the time of the crisis in Beijing in 1989 until 1991. I think that was a period of genuine debate within the leadership of the Chinese Communist Party about the next steps in reform, whether the momentum of opening to the outside world would be maintained. That uncertainty was resolved by Deng Xiaoping decisively in 1992, and that opened the path to a period of exceptionally rapid progress in reform, and the 1990s became a period of very strong growth in the market economy and the private economy of China. That steady path was challenged, first of all, by the Asian financial crisis, which had a very big effect on China. And China responded with the biggest fiscal and monetary expansion the world has ever seen, which maintained growth and really gave rise to the era that Professor Wang told us about, the era of exceptionally strong growth in the first decade of this century. From 2000 until 2011, broken only briefly by the global financial crisis, China experienced the strongest sustained growth any economy has ever experienced, averaging about 10% per annum, stronger than Japan in the 1960s or Korea in the 1970s. It was the most investment-led growth that the world has ever seen, and Professor Wang described some of the characteristics of that period of growth, the production bubble associated with the investment bubble that created an asset bubble. Because it was so investment-led and infrastructure-led, it was the most energy and metals-intensive growth the world has ever seen. And that gave the world and Australia the resources boom that gave us exceptional prosperity from about 2003 until the Chinese model of growth changed in 2011. This was one of the periods when I was thought of as a pessimist about the Chinese economy, because Australian business, after they noticed what was happening in China with investment-led growth, it took them a few years to notice. But once they did, they started investing as if this period of Chinese growth would last forever. The peak of investment came just after the Chinese model of economic growth changed. Australian business invested, Australian and foreign business invested about $250 billion in the expansion of Australian resources capacity after the change in the Chinese model of economic growth. And most of that $250 billion investment will not return the cost of capital. I became a bit boring to my business friends in Australia during that period by saying this is all temporary and transitional, that is not going to continue like this. Well, that period of investment-led growth in China had to come to an end for several reasons. It had to come to an end because, as Professor Wang mentioned, it was built on cheap labor. And by about 2005, that huge surplus of labor in the Chinese countryside, which had moved to the city to as a demand for the industrial sectors expanded, had started to dry up. And from 2005, we started to see rapidly rising wages in the, first of all, the coastal cities of China, and then more and more parts of the countryside where Chinese labor was coming from. So that alone meant that that era of investment-led growth in China had to come to an end. But it also had to come to an end because elements of the Chinese population and the Chinese leadership recognized that that old pattern of growth had some highly damaging consequences that could not continue forever. One of these was that it was associated with rapidly rising inequality in the income of in the distribution of income and wealth until 2005, the wages share of national income had been steadily falling, the profit share rising, and that was giving rise to social tension. And the leaders of the Communist Party began to concern themselves with the possibility of widespread political unrest. Another consequence of the old pattern of growth from 2000 to 2011 was that it was extremely damaging to the Chinese environment and also the global environment, especially the highly energy-intensive nature of that growth and the fact that almost all of the energy came from coal, because that was the cheap and abundant form of energy in China. And gradually, through that first decade of the century, concern about the environmental consequences of that pattern of growth increased. Domestic concerns about effects on health became very important. And also, China became more sensitive to the effects of Chinese energy consumption and coal combustion on the global environment, the global climate. Just to illustrate how important China was in that global environmental picture, from 2000 to 2011, there was quite strong growth in global greenhouse gas emissions, mostly from increases in coal consumption, and all of the increase in global consumption of coal in that first decade of the century was in China. The Chinese pattern of growth to 2011 had to change for income distribution reasons, environmental reasons, as well as for the in recognition of the reality that labor was no longer in super abundance. So since I date the implementation of the new policy, I call it the new model of Chinese growth from 2011. Now, Professor Wang tonight has given us some of the characteristics of that growth, a very strong emphasis on science and technology and technological innovation, strong emphasis on increasing services expenditure and consumption, reduction in investment in ways that reduce demand for metals, all associated with a slower rate of growth, a fall from an average of around 10% to growth in the range 6 or 7%. Now, this transition is really challenging, really difficult. That makes this the second time in the last 35 years when I've been following closely the Chinese economy where I think there are genuine questions about where China is, the Chinese economy is heading next. To take the next stage in growth, to move away from that investment-led growth into a more sophisticated economy that makes the transition from upper-middle income into the ranks of the incomes of the developed countries, which the Chinese leadership is committed to do, is going to require changes in lots of institutions, in the quality of markets. It's going to require some thinking of aspects of political organization and the political system. And these things are fundamentally difficult, and we will observe over the next few years how that turns out. If China succeeds in this transition and becomes a developed economy with high incomes, incomes like Australians or Americans, in a couple of decades' time, and that is the consequence of success with the new model of growth, then it follows as a matter of arithmetic that China becomes a very large part of the global economy, not the small part of the triangle, Professor Wang, but actually a rather large part of the of the triangle. That will be accompanied by changes in political institutions systemic arrangements that at this stage it is very difficult to predict, but one would be surprised if there were no change and adaptation on some political arrangements with such a fundamental change in the economic foundations of the society. If China succeeds in this transition, then there are very large opportunities for Australia, very different from the old resources opportunities. They will be in services, in high quality agricultural products, in science and technology, in specialist high value manufactured goods. It's a characteristic of all of these industries that you actually have to know the people that you're dealing with very closely if you are to succeed. It's different from selling hundreds of millions of tons of iron or coal, where you can have very high values of trade without close interaction between societies. So Australia will only make good use of these opportunities if it comes to understand the Chinese that they are dealing with much more closely, much more intimately. So the change in the nature of the opportunities will demand much more understanding of China from Australians. I thought that Professor Wang's placing sport in the mix of opportunities for Australia was interesting. And you may not be aware, Professor Wang, but that Australia invented modernity and we were the first high-income society. The 140 years ago, average incomes in this city were about 40% higher than New York average incomes. This was the first country in the world where labour was so scarce and valuable and self-confident that it was able to demand a Saturday afternoon off. And so on Saturday afternoon in Melbourne in the 1880s, you had huge crowds watching football games between suburbs of the city of Melbourne, between South Melbourne and Carlton, 23,000 people in a game in 1883. That was long before the National Football League or Basketball or Baseball League in the United States attracted mass crowds, way before English soccer attracted large crowds. And it wasn't that Australians are uniquely talented. It was that we were the first country to experience modernity, high incomes, scarce and valuable labour, self-confident labour. So you're quite right to look to Australia for partnership in these things. We've lived with these things for a very long time. But not only that, as you observe, science and technology as well. Finally, Professor Wang said some very challenging things about the shape of international relations in the future. One thing we can be sure about is that in a world in which China succeeds in transition to high income status, then the billion plus people in China, and even with declining population, China will still have more than a billion people in the middle of this century, much more than a billion people. That will make it an economy as large as Europe and America together, and that has large implications for the strategic shape of the world. And this really forces Australia to think about its place in the world. We, as Professor Wang observed, we have very strong attachment to our traditional relationships these days, especially to the United States, an alliance born out of the threat to Australian independence and liberty at the time of Japanese imperialism in the 1940s, and the overhang of anxiety about that at the time of the ANZUS Treaty in 1951. And Australians will not not easily or readily or lightly look past the importance of those historic relationships. But as I've written in the past, that's not inconsistent with Australia making the effort to understand well and have close and productive relations with other parts of the world, especially with the important countries in Australia's neighbourhood, and simply as a matter of economic and demographic arithmetic, China and with China, India and Indonesia are going to be necessarily very important parts of Australia's strategic environment. We are not going to succeed as a country without close and productive relations with all of those countries. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Garnaut, for your response to Professor Wang's presentation from an Australian perspective. And now, please allow me to invite both of you, both of the professors, back to the stage for a Q&A session with our audience. 非常荣幸地邀请 Wang Depei 教授与 Ross Garnaut 教授一起坐到前面来回答我们 观众要提出的问题, I'm told that Professor Wang loves sharp questions, loves challenges, so I'm sure we will have lots of questions from the audience. So my colleagues settling our speakers down. So I'll just hand on, and can I trouble you to go back to the very, very back? Yeah, and for the very first question, and if you could let us know just very briefly who you are and which organization you're from, that would be great. Are we ready? Oh, good.
Good evening. My name is Giovanni Butera. I work for an Indian company, and my question is about the important triangle that we've been discussing tonight. And I haven't heard about what will be in 5 years' time the role of India in the hegemony amongst the superpower countries that you mentioned. I heard about UK that is going through an interesting evolution, and that is the biggest question mark that we will, in my opinion, have in the next few years. But I haven't seen a role played of India in this future state in the year 2040 that we have been discussing about. And I'm very curious to understand how come, if it was just a position that is not considered evolving in a matter that can become challenging for the other countries, the other superpowers, or whether it's, there are diversity in the way they are planning to grow their economy or their social welfare. So I'm just curious to hear a little bit more about this. Thank you.
Thank you. So we'll just wait for the translation.
I did mention India in my concluding remarks, but I remember a conversation I had with Foreign Minister Chen Chichen in Beijing in the beginning of 1988, and we were talking about the future strategic shape of the world, and he said there will be three great powers: an expanded Europe, the United States and China, and everything will depend on relations between these three great powers. I said, what about the Soviet Union? This is 1988, and he said, oh, it will fall apart and Eastern Europe will become part of Europe. I said, what about India? And he said, India will not have enough economic momentum and economic strength to be such a large player. Well, since then, I've been talking about four great powers. I've taken a lead from Xi Jinping, but I've always included India in those four great powers. One must start to wonder a little bit about Europe as it frays around the edges, but I think that is just fraying around the edges. The big efforts being made to make little England little again, I don't think that that will be, in the end, a transformational development that will undermine the emergence of four great centres of power that will shape international relations through much of this century.
印度是一个伟大的民族，是中国的好邻居。但是，联合国常任理事国的位置只有五个。这些年，印度在积极的申请加入。我相信有一天，印度会加入世界常务理事国的名单。11月1号，让中国的人民币成为 世界货币基金组织SDR5个货币，美元、欧元、人民币、日元和英镑，名额有限，在世界货币基金组织内依然只选了这五张货币，但是它绝对不影响印度未来有一个很好的前程。
India is a great nation and also is a great neighbor of China. But in the United Nations, there are only five standing members for the standing committee. And India has been actively applying to join the committee, but it hasn't succeeded yet. And also, recently, the IMF has included RMB into the reserve currency, so that makes the reserve currencies, including the U.S. dollars, the European dollars, and the RMB, and the Japanese yen, and the English pounds. They still chose to go with these five currencies. However, this doesn't really change the fact that I believe India will have a bright future.
Thank you very much. Thank you, professors. And question from the audience? Yeah, we've got one. Yeah. Do you have a question?
Sure. Yeah. My name is Rhys Roberts, Roberts Gray Lawyers. Thank you for the informative, interesting presentations that you both gave. We learned a lot about China and Australia and the relationships between the countries and the global political aspects as well. I was told that Professor's interested in a very pointed and difficult question, and I'm happy to ask one. My question's about the South China Sea. Not the best one.
An economic question?
Economic question.
Yep. Predictions.
So in terms of economic...
It's a good question.
Yeah.
It's a good question. You can keep asking.
Yep.
I've been asked.
我回答不了，有高教授回答。
In terms of AFL and sport, how could we as a nation and a people benefit economically from bringing sport into China?
我这么回答，在这个话题上，澳中是坐在一条板凳上。
In terms of the 是说南中国海是吗？ 你是说哪个话题？
前两天 到国际法院去起诉澳大利亚，说澳大利亚侵占了东帝汶的岛屿。但是澳大利亚外交部长对外的言论和中国外交部长对外的言论是一样一样的，所以我认为我们是坐在一条板凳上的。
In terms of South China Sea, I want to talk about the East Timor as well. Recently, East Timor sued Australia for territory disputes. And I believe that the Australian Minister for Foreign Affairs made exactly the same speech and announcement as the Chinese counterpart. So I believe that in this issue, China and Australia are on the same boat. 然后他另外一个
而且我预测未来中国和澳大利亚将在印度尼西亚会师。死了。
And I predict that the forces, and I predict that Australia and China will meet their forces in Indonesia.
但不是军队啊。
But no armies.
它是共享经济。我相信中国、澳大利亚、印度尼西亚、印地文、菲律宾都将在共享经济的背景下有一个很好的合作。
It's not army, it's not military, but more about to share the economy, to share the same economy. The countries including China, Indonesia, Australia, East Timor, and Philippines, they will all share the economic benefits.
对此，菲律宾总统杜特尔特已经做了积极的行为。
And the president of Philippines have already taken very positive actions. 他问的另外一个问题是对于向中国引进，刚才就老师刚才提起这件事情，对于澳大利亚会带来什么的益处
？Yeah, he's translating.
会对澳大利亚带来怎样的益处和影响？
中国引进橄榄球，对澳大利亚来说就意味着文化的扩张和体育的扩张，所以我在11号的年度总决赛贵宾时，那天总理也在，外交部长也在，他们对外发布了3条改革举措。第一个，要把橄榄球扩展到我们原住民那，让原住民成立橄榄球队。第二个，破天荒的在世界范围内的率先将推出澳大利亚女性的橄榄球队。第三条，认为澳大利亚的橄榄球应该到最大的人口国家，到中国去。所以我认为澳大利亚进入到了一个改革的年代。
In terms of bringing AFL to China and the effect to Australia, it is actually cultural expansion and sports expansion. And when I was at the grand final, the Prime Minister and the ministers were there, and they made announcement of 3 reforms. One is that they're going to form indigenous teams. The second is they're going to form the first women's team. The third one is they are going to bring the sports, the AFL as a sports into the most populated country in the world, which is China. So I believe Australia has entered an era of reform.
Thank you. And we have a third question there.
Yeah,
thank
sure. You. Hi, my name is Tim. I work for Sullivan Cromwell, an American law firm, in their capital markets department. And so, sort of related to that theme, how important is the development and sophistication of the Chinese banking industry to its future success? Or would you agree that this idea of a debt-fueled economy run by banks is a Western concept that does not necessarily fit with China's growth for the future or strategy for the future?
我的问题就是说，那在中国，银行的这个银行的系统对于经济的影响到底是您觉得是怎么样？另外一个就是对于债务的管理，那中国是以银行为导向的这样的债务的管理和环境，是否因为是西方的一个格式，还是说中国也可以采用，还是中国的？
这位专家提的很有道理。在2015年，中国整个金融政策的风格有一点像华尔街，
但是中国这个国家它特别看重社会的稳定问题，所以互联网金融 P2P 出了许多事情，最后国家就毅然决然进行止损，就不允许 P2P 以一种无序的方式在发展，甚至华尔街的那种金融衍生商品这样的一种势头也在进行遏制，特别是对我们银行。 把存款转变成理财产品，这样的做法也受到了国家金融政策的管控，所以我估计，接下来的几年，中国的银行业将相当的艰难，大量的职工将下岗。但是金融业的萎缩，在一定意义上讲，对实体经济、对中国经济的转型是一个好事情。
That is a very good question. In 2015, many policies related to economics in China looks very similar to has a hint of the Wall Street style. However, China values its stability very much. So when P2P or internet finance had so many problems, Chinese government decided to stop the loss and try to stop it from happening in an orderless environment or without any regulation. And I think in Wall Street, they're trying to stop some wild products, financial products as well. In terms of turning deposit into wealth management products, Chinese government have decided to take that into control as well. So I would say that it will be a hard time for Chinese banking industry, and many people will lose their job. But for the development of the real economy and Chinese economic transformation, it is actually a good thing.
Thank you. And I think we've got the very last question from over there. Thank you.
王教授您好，那个我是莫大环境专业的学生，想请那个翻译先生帮我翻译一下我的问题，谢谢。因为刚刚有听到您讲说顶层设计对于这个发展的作用并不是那么大，然后的话，我之前有看过前世行行长林毅夫他的观点就是产业政策，产业政策对于这个。 企业家在发展的时候可以帮助他们克服外部性和这个基础设施等完善的协调的问题，所以我想请您辨析一下，顶层设计或者说产业政策等这样政府这一块对于这个经济发展之间这种不同的观点的一个关系，谢谢。你要先翻好。
I'm a student of the University of Melbourne, and I'm from the Environment Faculty. And my question is actually about the top level design you were talking about, and how it doesn't really have much impact on the economic development of the country. The former director of the Bank of World have commented that the industry policies has certain influence and impacts in terms of internal structures and internet coordination. And I would like to see if you have any different opinions in terms of the government's policies impact or influence on the development of economy.
姑娘这个问题让我有一种冲动，几乎想用半天来回答你。
Your question. Your question gave me this urge that I would like to answer this I would like to spend half of the day to answer your question.
1992年为标志，计划经济退出历史舞台。美国许多精英认为，未来的世界就是美国模式。结果2008年，美国的市场经济极端的自由的也出了洋相，所以全世界都面临。 如何寻找第三条道路？在这个过程中，中国的一些产业政策 有成功的，有失败的。在激进市场竞争的领域内的那些产业政策，往往是失败的。在一个国家特有的一些难以替代的那些产业领域内，中国的产业政策是成功的。特别是在当下，去 WTO， 国与国的竞争又开始重新抬头的背景下，反映国家战略意志的产业政策，每个国家都在做，所以在这个领域内，产业政策是必须的。但是中国目前在推动市场经济发展过程中，还没有形成一个稳定的、持续的、可复制可推广的产业政策。但是中国的市场经济的这个节奏已经不可逆了，所以我相信我们以往所熟悉的产业政策将渐渐地淡出历史。
1992 was the turning point for China, where the planned economy fade away and stepped out of the stage of history. And at that time, many elites in the US believed that the world will only have the economies like of the US style. But in 2008, they have shown their problems as well. And it's a huge one. So many countries in the world are actually looking for a third path. And in terms of in this process, China has made a lot of industry policies, and those who are trying to control the competition in the market, most of them failed, and those who are controlling the areas, the industrial areas that is in unreplaceable, they succeeded. So in the WTO, currently the competitions between countries are getting more and more obvious, and in terms of strategic decisions, many countries are making them, and I would say it is actually necessary for them to make them. And for China, although we haven't really established as consistent policies to manage to proceed further with our market economy, but in China's case, market economy is inevitable, and I believe the industry policies that we are familiar with will fade away and step out of the history as well.
好，我想可能这个环节就到这里。非常感谢王教授，感谢 Ross Garnaut 教授和我们的观众直接做交流。So I think this will mark the end of the Q&A session with our audience. So on behalf of event partners tonight, that is the Virtual Australia Foundation, Asia Link, the Confucius Institute at the University of Melbourne, the Centre for Asian Business and Economy Economics, Asia Link Business, I would like to thank you all for your attendance, in particular. Thank you.
我想讲句话，谢谢各位友好的提问。我今天是做好了把鞋扔上来的心理准备，但是没想到莫大如此文明，如此友好。
Thank you very much for your friendly questions, and I was actually prepared to welcome the shoes coming my way, but that didn't happen. So thank you very much for all your hospitality and friendship. Thank you.
Yeah. And I would also like to thank, in particular, the delegation of Shanghai Entrepreneur Association, 也特别致谢新互相联合会代表团的所有成员，感谢您们今天晚上莅临我们的活动。And secondly, everybody, please join me in thanking our interpreter, Marcus Liu, tonight from Qian Communications. Thank you. Thank you, Marcus, for your hard work.And lastly, everybody, let's have another round of applause for our two distinguished speakers tonight, Professor Wang Depei and also Professor Ross Garnaut. Thank you. 谢谢. Yeah. And now I would like to invite Professor Simon Evans, Pro Vice Chancellor International at the University of Melbourne, to present gifts to our two speakers on behalf of the university. Thank you. 非常感谢. 谢谢. Yeah. I think also we've got a gift for Professor John Taplin. Without you, tonight's event will not happen. So thank you very much. So can I invite you, and Simon will present the gift to you. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight, and we look forward to seeing you in the future. 非常感谢，希望大家以后继续支持我们的活动。晚安，Thank you.